As we're getting close to finishing out the first quarter of our prophetic roadmap that God has gave us. But this is something that today we in Proverbs 12 want to share with you. And we both are extremely passionate about it. And we do believe that this is strongly, Jordan Taylor, one of our assignments of what God has called us individually to be on the earth, but God has also called us to tag team.
Recognize is a cause to occur at the same time or rate. To cause to go on, to move, operate, work at the same rate and exactly together. I'm going to say that again. Cause to occur at the same time or rate. To cause to go on, move, operate, work at the same rate, exactly together.
As we look at it, we can look very deep into the Holy Spirit, but it is the Spirit of God.
Yes.
Let's look into the scripture. We just want to build the case. And amen. Let's read it, Mike, real quick. Thank you, Dee.
However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you to all truth. For he will not speak of his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come.
So we see here that the Holy Spirit is a person. He's not an id. He's not goosebumps. Somebody say he has a real personality.
He's a real personality.
What we're asking God the next 2 weeks is to synchronize us as the person of the Holy Spirit. We're not going to yell, we're just going to really just talk to you. This concept is one of the most profound concepts. If you get this concept of becoming one, exactly together with the Spirit of God, your life will absolutely change forever. There are so many people that rather have an encounter with a gift and totally miss because the greatest gift that Jesus ever given us, and that is the Holy Spirit. I mean, this is one of my life, as well as hers. Troy's love to teach on him. Somebody say he's a person.
He's a person.
You can't catch him.
He's a person.
Carl, he's a living person.
He's a living person.
That's why I use the concept. What y'all? He.
Yeah.
He is a personality. So we're asking God over the next 2 weeks to teach us how to become one with the presence of the Lord. God's been dealing with us and getting our hearts right. And as he began to minister to me all week, even this Wednesday, God shifted the service. We went to a prophetic teaching about the God. Left me naked with one word, shift. And what we want to teach you today is, I hope you catch this before it's easy, I hope you're ready to receive. This is something we can't make you, but I know for our home and our desire as your pastors, we're praying that you will come in alignment with
hell. Amen.
If you come in alignment with him, everything you desire, it will happen. But it's funny because the Holy Spirit is the most important person in the world. But we rarely teach you about him. But we want to take the next 40 minutes to teach you. So synchronize me, Taylor, is a declaration that we are declaring to the heavens that God, Cena, will cause us to occur with the Holy Spirit at the same time. And that God will cause us to go on, to make moves, to operate, choice, or to work exactly together with the Holy Spirit.
All right.
So when we use the concept, synchronize me, we're asking that the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, do you understand that God's Spirit wants to commune with you? If you really understood that concept that a God wants to commune with you until you and him become one. I know you say, well, he's busy. He loves you enough to become one with you. We're sharing secrets with you of how God has used us and all the kind of stuff, because we both desire, before I even call, before I'm trying to hit the nations, I want to be synchronized with the Spirit. Before I saw God heal cancer for people, before I saw, because I saw God heal people and set me, I saw it all. But one thing I've always asked myself, never let me lose my secretness of it.
Amen.
The Spirit of God.
Amen.
Because if we ever get past not being one with Him, we think our gift is what does it. But if we stay in a place of being one with the Spirit, with the Spirit of God,
right,
that's absolutely phenomenal. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
They're looking at four keys. And if you get these keys, you will go home after pullover today after you leave dinner with us. These keys will unlock things at your home. These keys will have you absolutely in the back room getting some towels at work, and they'll be able to count it from God.
Amen.
And you will know it's tangibly in Him.
Yes.
Now, well, I know I'm talking about knowing it's Him. You ready?
Yes.
That's how you're teaching the word.
All right, so let's look into these four awesome keys to encounter the presence of God. Let's look at Psalms 27 and 4. Go ahead,
Pete. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple.
So the key point we want to pull out of that is desire. One of the keys that we must have to encounter His presence is the desire to encounter His presence. So let's look at the definition of desire. It's a want, expect, request, ask, to long for. So we have to want to encounter with the presence of God above all else, no matter how we feel, no matter what we're dealing with. We want to have that desire every single day. We want to have that desire to get closer and closer to His presence. Just like you desire food, or just like you desire your husband or your wife, you have to have that same desire for the presence of God. God, I won't move until you tell me to move, God. God, I'm going to stay right here like a cocoon into your presence, God, until you tell me it's time. God, I desire that oneness. Synchronize me with you, God. God, move me with you. I desire to move with you. I desire to go with you. I desire the oneness with you, God. I desire the oneness with nobody else but you. God, I need you. I desire everything about you. Everything about you.
Then it says above all. The question is, do you desire Him above everything?
Yes.
Is your job above His presence? Is your spouse above His presence? Is your children above His presence? Are your worries above your presence? So we want to encounter Him, Natasha. We first got to have a want of His presence.
Yes.
When is the last time we, as a body, and I'm talking about globally, really discovered? Many of us are trying to perfect our gift so much, instead of totally missing Him, the necessity, mama, of the presence of the Lord. We have to desire, and we're provoking all of us, as God was speaking to us, He's calling us above everything else, put my presence first.
Yes.
Above your car, above your home, above your I'm tired. Don't be so tired that that you're not desiring. Another word for desire and want is to be without. See, you got to get to the point that you can't live without.
Yeah.
Come on.
The presence of the. See, you can live without a car.
Mm-hmm.
See, you can live without a job. See, See, you can live without your spouse. But if you really understand the capacity of the Spirit of God, you want him, and you will fight for your want. You won't let nothing separate you from your desire of his presence. A lot of times we're fighting Pastor Toy up here, and a lot of times we're fighting demonic, and that's great. But I'm telling you this afternoon what he's after: your desire. If he gets your desire for the presence, he's won the battle. And I'm not talking about a desire that's one time. I'm talking about a continual desire to be in his presence. Many of us struggle on Sundays and Wednesdays or whatever church is because you don't have a desire through the week. But God is challenging us here. We have to have our want to encounter the presence of God in me above all else. Somebody say above all else.
Above all else.
Also, we have to train our spirit to have an expectation for the presence of God. Expectation is a feeling, Carl, while you're waiting for something to happen. We as believers have to have we have to train our spirit to expect or have an expectation to become one with the Spirit of God. We have to train our spirits. Now, flesh, we got to train our spirits to become one with the presence of God.
Yes, and just to add on to that, it's just like when a baby is born and they have to be trained to talk. They have to be trained to dialogue with you. That's what God desires. We don't just get saved and then automatically we know how to desire God's presence. We have to be trained and developed to know how to go into his presence, what to do in his presence, how to hear in his presence, activate those senses in his presence. It's so important that we have trained, that we train ourselves to be able to expect his presence. Amen.
All right, now, one more point for desire. We have to long for the presence of God as we anticipate the oneness between God and us and God. You have to long for like a yearning. When's the last time you just longed to be in his presence? You didn't want nothing.
Yes.
You just wanted to, you just wanted to talk to, you just wanted to be around the presence of God. When's the last time you just said, I know I've come to you for the last 4 months about my bills, but today, I don't want nothing. I just want to just be one with you. I'm not talking about you coming to church.
All right.
Come on now.
I'm not talking about you saying, I'm serving as a deacon, an elder, a bishop. I'm not talking about that.
Yeah.
I'm talking about when is the last time you had a longing without a title just to talk to people. Yeah. I'm not talking about training yourself, hear me, to desire the presence of the Lord. If the enemy gets your desire, Carl, I ain't smoked weed in years. I don't have a desire for it. So just put something in front of me, man. Do anything. So the enemy knows what we like and we don't. But he's after your desire for the presence. Don't tell me you're busy either. Because God is more busy than everybody in here today. Well, I ain't got the time. You shouldn't say that either. God that sits high and does everything. Right now, while we're ministering about him, he's healing people in Afghanistan. Because his presence is what makes the difference.
When you're longing for his presence, it's like a yearning and like a pull to his presence, anticipating him to come down right where you are. When you're longing for something, when you're desiring something, you will almost do whatever it takes to get what you want. But God is saying, will you desire me enough? Will you long for me enough to do whatever it takes to get me right where you are? Will you do whatever it takes? Will you give up whatever you need to give up? Will you cut off who you need to cut off? Will you separate what you need to separate? Will you move what you need to move to get me? to our job, everywhere we go, we must desire and long for the presence of God.
There has to be over us trying to get 1,000 likes.
Yes.
There has to be over us trying to make our business famous. It's a necessity. If you really understood the capacity of you desiring just a God that wants to live in you, through you, that's absolutely a miracle. So the first point we want to share with you, if you're going to encounter him daily, you must first have a desire for his presence. Number two,
you, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water.
Next one.
As the deer longs for the streams of water, so I long for you, O God. I thirst for God, the living God. Can I go and stand before him?
You see, the word, the next point is after you join on to have a desire for the presence, it's important for us to develop a hunger for the presence. So after you have a desire, church, it's important for us to now start developing the thing that we are desiring. What does the word develop? It means to create by training or teaching or to cause to grow. Somebody say, develop a hunger for the presence of God.
Develop a hunger for the presence of God.
So what is one of the keys? We must train our spirits to hunger for the presence of God. See, when we get to the place that we understand him, the necessity and the importance of the presence of God in our lives, we will train our spirit that if you ever get out of line with the Spirit of God, let me know. We should train our spirits because God's whole intention is to live in mankind and to have a relationship with you. So we have to train our spirit. And sometimes when it comes to training can hurt.
Yeah.
Training sometimes, Carl, is effective and is good, but there can be some heartaches through training. And what was you saying, Pastor? If you may not want to get up tomorrow, train your spirit to get up. You may not, and I'm sleeping, man. I work 12 hours, and God is calling you to spend time with you, and you say, God, I'm sleeping. Train your spirit to spend that one extra hour, not knowing when you're in his presence, he's going to give you some strength to make you feel like you never went a day of job. But we got to train ourselves to encounter him. And sometimes in church, we think that you automatically know how to encounter him, but we never train you how to encounter him. We have to help you develop after your desire is in place, because now it's time to develop you and start training your spirit so that you can have an encounter way beyond church.
Yeah.
I'm talking about you, God. Hear me? Just chilling. And what just happened? It just, why are you crying? Just love. And sometimes you won't cry because you don't want to be just emotional. I'm talking about a tangible presence where you can just feel his presence. It's like, see, he ain't got to say nothing, but his presence speaks a lot. He ain't got to come up, Carl, and say, I'm here. He's just coming. And just him being around is enough. He ain't got to talk. Just be with me.
I'm feeling the training, just like you see a trainer at the gym. You know the difference of those who are training and those who are not. You see the results of those who are training themselves. It takes discipline to do it. But you can see the difference from somebody that's being trained and developed into their seat. You see the fruit, you see the evidence. Let your heart be the altar. You have to train yourself that your heart be the altar for God to come and dwell. You have to train yourself to put food away. Sometimes God is calling you not just for the corporate fast, but your individual fast. There may be some things that he might be preparing you for that you may not even know that's happening in the future, and he wants you to fast. And if you don't fast, you may not be able to handle what is coming your way. So it's so important that you train yourself in developing a hunger for the presence of God.
Next point is very powerful. We must be educated on the presence of God. The word develop means to create by training and teaching. So we must be educated. How can you develop on something that you lack education on? If you're going to walk into this field and, hey, I'm going to be a developer on this, this, and that, you first have to get some education based on what you're getting trained on. Why do you think all last year we did a whole year of teaching on the Holy Spirit? That was to train you or to educate you on the what? The presence of God. And hear me. Well, see, and it, what happens here is we never teach nobody about the education of his presence. We assume that you know about it. Now, what happens, Tasha, if I mislost it, but I'm teaching you? That means there's two generations that's uneducated on his presence that's totally missing out on the one is thinking that he can have. So how can you be around something without being educated about you? When you get to dating somebody, when, you get to, when I met Pastor Troy, I had to learn a lot about her. She had to learn a lot about me. I had to educate myself on Atoya as a person. You can't assume I know a lot about her. I don't care how long you've been saved. If nobody taught you, you can't assume that you know everything about the Holy Spirit. You don't.
Amen.
And that's why we're supposed to train you. But it's kind of pastoral fault, and I apologize. Because we're teaching you so much about what to go get. Hear me. It's telling you who to go get.
That's good.
Come on, man.
You missed that?
That's good.
We're teaching you. Go get your blessings. Here come this. Here come that. And that's great. They're coming.
Yeah.
But we never teach you about who to go get.
That's good.
And if you get him, all of what you're going to get, come on. You can't get him. But hear me. Our development is in the wrong place.
Yeah.
I get saved. I got a couple prophecies. I started developing my prophetic call, my apostolic call. I started developing, and I'm totally missing. I should be developing my education on the Holy Spirit. My people are destroyed because of lack of what?
Knowledge.
Me, it is so powerful, daughter. He didn't say worldly people. He said my people. So that means us as believers will miss out on great encounters because we're ignorant of his presence. How do you know he's there? Nobody ever taught you when he's coming.
Right.
How do you know he's there when you don't even know what to touch and feel like? We can assume that the church know how to.
Yeah.
And that's why we're doing today. We're educating you on his presence. Somebody say, educate me.
Educate me
on his presence.
On his presence.
See, this type of teaching, Pastor, this ain't just for a regular Sunday person. This was somebody that really, while they're at home, while they're late night, man, I just want to feel your presence. I'm looking to raise up a church. I don't care how God got that. I want to be some people. When they come in and say, man, your church is some people hungry for his presence. See, that makes when people come here and minister, you have to come full because my people are already ready and they're hungry for the presence of God. See, you can't come in like that. You have to come in on full because we're going to pull because we're hungry to have a tangible encounter. Not an experience, but an encounter. See, an experience will leave you saying church was good, but an encounter will get you up out of here saying church has absolutely changed me. Why has it changed me? Because a real God in his presence.
It's good.
Yeah.
It's good.
And even though he's omnipresent, he does not manifest himself everywhere.
Yes.
Somebody say, educate me.
Educate me.
On his presence.
On his presence.
So God is calling us to grow when it comes to hungering for his presence.
Yes.
He's causing us to stretch and go a little deeper. It takes us kneeling, it takes us bowing, it takes us sacrificing and killing this flesh so that we may go deeper into his presence. Do you know that the deeper that you go, the farther you will grow? The deeper, I'm just saying this again, the deeper that you go, the farther you will grow. The more that his presence, I mean, we want to get to a place where he meets us there. Where we already know, we can sense him in the room, like, okay, God,
here
I come. Will we meet then? 12 o'clock.
I promise that, Pastor. We got people from Muskegon that come mornings and people that about Pastor. I don't think they get on the highway every Sunday just because we're Pastor who. I think the beautiful ladies, which will be buying us dinner today, y'all don't know that, but receive it. Hallelujah. Let's get back to the teaching. Amen. That's the class. All right. I love them. She loved them. But we want to be blessing y'all today with dinner, so just come ride with Pastor, all right? Cool. Amen. But they come here faithfully, Carl. Don't ask for nothing. Don't never say nothing. When I try to give them something, they look at me like I'm crazy. But they come because I believe both of them understand there's something called the presence of the Lord in this room. And here, there was a time when people were coming from like Lansing and Detroit, and it was early. I said, God, what is up with this? He was just giving us a glimpse. People is tired of just regular church, guys.
Yeah.
People is tired of just regular, all of that cliche. Yeah. Listen, if I come, my number one question is, will God be there?
Yeah.
If God is not there, I stay. My wife said, God is calling us to grow when it comes to his hunger. You should never get to the level where you think that you're absolutely, I'm full. If you ever get to the level where you think you have mastered the presence of God, you are totally in error and you totally missed the relationship of the deepness that the Holy Spirit wants to have in me with a fleshly man or a woman. If we ever get to the level where we think, I never want to get to that level where the Holy Spirit has hit a ceiling. Can't go no higher because us as people won't let it. And religion, I ain't got time to, we'll do it. It's killing our services today.
Yeah.
Small, big, large, tall, all around. How in the world we say the Holy Spirit is his guest, but you lock him out when it's time for him to enter? How in the world do we think the church can see revival without the spirit of revival?
Yes.
How in the world you think you're going to see people being healed and delivered without the spirit of God, which is the power of God?
Yes.
How in the world, mama, we want to get people unlocked, hear me, from concealed to revealed,
yes,
if we don't tap into the spirit, which is the spirit of revelation?
Yes.
How in the world we going to set you free if we don't allow the spirit of truth to come in?
Yes.
It's his church.
Yes.
You say that.
Yes.
If it's his church, let him have his way.
Yes.
Somebody say, develop my hunger.
Develop my hunger.
Somebody say, develop my hunger.
Develop my hunger.
All right. Number three.
Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded.
Next one.
Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water.
Say, draw me closer.
Draw me closer.
So the next key that we want to talk about is draw towards the presence of God. You must draw towards his presence. Let's take a look at his definition. It means to proceed. That's a movement. To move by pulling, to tug. To encounter the presence of God, we sometimes have to proceed to make the first move. A lot of the times in church, a lot of the times in our individual life, we wait on God so many times. We're like, God, why aren't you here? God, why aren't you doing this? Or why don't I feel you? God is saying, I'm waiting for you to draw near to me. I'm waiting for you to proceed, move. And he's looking for somebody with clean hands, pure heart to do something. So God is drawing us, he's tugging us, but we must make the first step to move towards him. I want to be to a point where I beat him into the room.
Oh, hallelujah.
I want to be in a point where, okay, God, you was waiting on me, I apologize. And he'd be like, I've been waiting on you. I want to be to that point where we know I don't even have to schedule the time in, and his presence is just automatically there. Yeah. Because I took myself to draw towards his presence. I didn't need no worship leader. I don't need no preacher. I don't need somebody to tell me to lift my hand, shout glory. But I know when the Lord is in the room, I'm going to draw near, pulling and tugging on his presence.
Go back real quick, dog. Look what it says. This, now, we want you to catch this. Another translation says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you.
Yes.
Erica, that is so profound. Because a lot of us are, as my wife said, we're waiting for him to make the move. Nikki, he reversed it. He said, there's some time I want you to show me that you're chasing me.
Yeah.
Come on. Come on.
You ever had back in the days a little crush?
Man.
And you chased him. Yeah. You stopped. Said, I'm tired of doing the chasing. I'm going to walk somewhere and let you chase me. God is saying, I'm tired of chasing you. Why don't you take some time to chase me sometimes? And God is saying in this hour, after you have a desire for his presence, so now you start developing that hunger. Now he's saying, ooh, now baby, now I can just start drawing towards me. But what do you mean? Why I always gotta be the one to say good morning? Why I always gotta be the one to say, hear me now, I love you? Why can't you wake up and roll out your bed and just say, man, you know what, I just love you. I don't want nothing there. I just love you.
Yeah.
I like that, Pastor. I said, hear me. It's really like if you do something, I'll do something.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you draw, how do you draw, Pastor? Worship, praise, love. Just, remember, y'all, he's a person.
Yes.
Quit. He's a person. He's a
living person.
And you feel me? Talk to him. On your way to work. Hey, man, I just... What you doing, man? I see some of y'all in the box when it comes to him. That's why y'all scared to talk to him. You like, oh, holy, hallelujah. He like, man, chill. What's good? Why, you know why? Because he talks to you, versus your personality. Talk to him. He'll talk back. I promise you.
Good.
Just rally you come. Man, what you doing today, man? What you got, Holy Spirit? I know you go all over the world. What you doing today? He might give you on the secret or some stuff. He might tell you when you get to, they didn't tell you this, but they're watching you for promotion. Hey, don't tell you heard it from me. See, you got to build that relationship with the Holy Spirit, because he will give the reveal things to you. And absolutely.
Yeah.
He'll tell you who ain't good for me. He'll tell you, but you got to start drawing, though. And I keep hearing God say all in my ear, well, can you chase me a little bit this year? Chase it. I'm talking about chasing it until you get it.
Yes.
You hear me? I mean, until you get it.
Yeah.
Well, I go to church. That ain't, we ain't talking about that. That's one avenue of drawing. I'm talking about having an encounter way outside of church.
Yeah.
Right at your job. Matter of fact, right at your cubicle. Let your boss come and say, why is my paper wet because of my tears? Why are you crying? Just the love of God. Who knew, cuz? That might be the very thing that your boss or your other boss need to hear. Well, if you can cry like that, tell me about that love. I'm glad you asked. But you have to draw towards him. Then the next point it says, when drawing closer to the presence of God, it's important that we have clean hands. Look what he said. He said, now I got to come to you washing hands. What you mean? If you're doing some things you ain't got no business doing, make sure. Now I can. But if you want me to stay, you got to clean up. Now I ain't got no problem coming, but I want to stay. But you got to make sure you got clean hands. Another scripture says, clean heart. Because what he's saying is, I want to be able to minister holy to holy. I want to be able to minister spirit to spirit.
That's good.
And I can't synchronize, watch this, Jordan, fully if the hands and the hearts are dirty.
That's good.
Now I can talk to you. But I want to live not on you. Watch this now. I want to live, Cynthia, in you. So we're going to encounter him while we're drawing. One way to do, we got somebody say, we got to wash our hands. And at our Passover service, we do a washing of hands and all of that. You might say, well, what you mean? It's symbolic to make sure your hands, the proper time for you, like those that serve in ministry. You're doing ministry with dirty hands, knowing your hands been in places they shouldn't have been. That's a scary place.
Next one, it's important to remove contaminants from your heart. Ask God every time you get into the presence of God. God, search my heart. God, I'm here. I follow God. I drew towards you, God. Now search my heart. Is there something in here that will stop you from synchronizing with me? Is there something in here that will stop you from drawing closer to me, God? God, search the very depths of me. Search the very inner works of my heart, God. You know that the heart is evil. God, and I ask you to search me. So as you are drawn to him, ask God to search your heart. Lay your heart down towards him so that he can cleanse and purge your heart. There may be some things that you may not even know that's still there.
Yes.
Unforgiveness, bitterness, anger, hatred.
Yes.
Let him take those things out so that there is no issue, there's
yes.
no boundaries, there's no roadblocks that will stop you from entering to his presence.
Another point in this one is when approaching the presence of God, it's important to be sincere and genuine.
Yes.
Next scripture, God is wealthy, well, thank you, sir. Let us draw near to God with that. What, y'all?
Sincere.
Feel me? Be true about it. Be genuine about the relationship.
Yes.
We all have been in a relationship with people, and you can tell as a friend, they just wasn't genuine like you were. And it make you feel, Carl, because hurt at the end, because I gave you all of my sincerity, my genuineness, and you didn't get it in return.
Yeah.
And I don't care what we say, that can hurt.
Yeah.
When you gave up on your sincerity, but you found out they wasn't genuine, or you ever had a person, Natasha, that you thought you were cool with and you were genuine, finding out they wasn't genuine with you. God is saying that when you come before me, let it be sincere.
Yeah.
You don't have to come with all of the, with everything in place. You don't have to come with every T crossing, every dot. You don't have to come like that. All he's saying is just come. See, it's my wife and I desire that we raise up a church that love God. Hear me. If God don't do it yet,
yeah.
I don't want you to be moved by your blessings. I want you to be moved
yes.
by his presence.
Amen. Yeah, amen.
Some of you won't get that to 20 years down the line. You'll be saying, thank you. Because we're trying to teach you about the most important person in the world. I know your mama off the chain. I know your pops is cooler than a family. And I know your boo thing is cute and a hug. I know all of that. I know your kids can't nothing do wrong. They're the best kids. They ain't never messed up. They're phenomenal. They're perfect. I know they're off the chain. And I'm laughing, but I'm serious.
Yes.
But the most important person in the world is the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
If the Holy Spirit leaves the earth today, we'll have murders without any conscience of killing. If the Holy Spirit leaves the earth today, we won't feel convicted when we've done wrong.
Yes.
If the Holy Spirit leaves the earth today, we'll just have buildings and won't have movements with God. If the Holy Spirit leaves the earth today, we have sellout crowds, but people won't get changed.
Yes.
If the Holy Spirit is not here today,
yes.
you can't even know who God is, because God is him and he's God.
Yes.
So without
yes.
him, how
yes.
do you even know him? If the Holy Spirit just said, I'm going today, I promise you, you think the world is wicked now. There'll be some stuff, climatically, I'm talking about on top of things and things and things. If the Holy Spirit decides and says, Pastor, I'm gone. And we ain't got time to really deal with it. But on Wednesday, a couple weeks ago, Mama, we talked about the wonderful priest
yeah.
that only went before his presence
yeah, yeah.
one time
yeah.
a year.
Yes. Yes.
I feel this. The powerful
yes.
with me.
Yes.
It's because in the Old Testament, you couldn't even experience God.
Yeah.
I hope you knew that.
Come on.
The singers didn't even get into the presence of God like that.
Yeah.
All the preachers didn't even get into the presence, cuz. But the Bible says the high priest went one time a year. So you telling me I gotta wait to encounter this God for one time a year? Y'all will be outside the court. Y'all have never experienced God like you do today. So when I say it's a blessing,
yeah,
to be able to experience and have an encounter with a God here, that now you don't have to wait one time.
Because
you can encounter him every single
minute,
every single day, every single second. You can encounter a God here that was limited in the Old Testament.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Hallelujah. One time a year, because they can encounter God. Question is, what happened if they blew that one time?
My God.
They would have to wait a whole year, not knowing you was next in line. So I don't know how long I had to wait to encounter a God that is freely given to us today. And I told them on a couple of women, if the Old Testament saints would call us, they said, y'all got a problem, New Testament.
Right.
Y'all arrogant, New Testament.
Yeah.
Y'all cocky, New Testament. We couldn't even encounter God. See, some of y'all don't know this, but the Holy Spirit was not released in the Old Testament like that. He used people, but he didn't live in people.
Right.
Ooh, that's deep.
Yeah, right.
So a whole books that he worked with people, cuz, but then after he's done working, cuz, he left.
Yeah.
To the New Testament. Now he just gonna work on you. God, he'll work in you.
Yes, yes.
Do you understand the benefit
Hallelujah.
Of just
Hallelujah.
That statement?
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Jesus.
Glory.
Thank you.
The priest will say,
thank you.
You can encounter him every day.
Wow.
And you ain't seizing the opportunity? You can open up your mouth and he can come through and sit among you.
Yes, God.
And it took us a whole year to encounter his presence. Just that statement is enough that will always keep me reminded. Watch this. Never get familiar with his presence. If David called, David would probably tell him to get to heaven. I love his heart, but he didn't manifest himself to me like that.
Yeah.
Moses probably said, I was a great man of God. I did some things, but God didn't never. He didn't minister like that. Elijah and the great prophets, Elisha, all them guys, and Ezekiel, they probably would say, man, God used us. But to encounter his presence like you do Paul, like you do Peter, like you do Natasha, like you do God, it's absolutely blessed. One time a year, they would get prepared to encounter something that now, because we can encounter every single day. That's deep.
Yeah.
And we were going to teach on that, but the Lord took it another way.
Yeah.
I really want to break that down. Because if you understood what Jesus did, he died so that now you can encounter him anyway.
Thank you.
He just didn't forgive your sins. He opened up the gateway to encounter him again.
Yes,
he just didn't wipe away your sins.
Yes.
He opened up the end and said, come in, let's talk. How we used to get.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
Easter is coming in. Church will be packed. And one day, we totally miss it. The cross is phenomenal.
Yeah.
But mama's when he got up out the grave.
Yes.
Because the grave gave us access to his presence.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
I even sense the Lord saying, will you value my presence? Will you value my presence like you value the most precious jewel or the most precious perfume or some oil, expensive oil? Will you value me that you won't just spare and you just won't spill out my presence and waste my presence? But will you take hold of my presence every chance you get? Will you see the value in the presence? As Pastor said, they didn't get to experience me like you can. Do not waste my presence. Do not take it for granted. Do not push my presence away. But continue to pull on me every day. Continue to show that you love me by pulling on me every day. Continue to show me that you care by pulling on me every hour. This year, y'all, don't waste his presence. You heard Pastor, people was expecting one time a year to get to the presence. And we can just turn and get to his presence.
One time.
Do not take his presence for granted. Take it for granted. Hallelujah.
Number four, be able to first have a desire for the presence. Number two, is developing a hunger for his presence. Number three is drawing towards presence. I want to teach on one. This is powerful. Go ahead, Wealthy Webb.
Then Moses said to him, if your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here.
Number four, total dependency on the presence of God. What does the word dependency? See, meaning it means the state of relying on or being controlled by someone or something else. It means to trust in someone or something. This is powerful, choice. Dependency is the birthing ground for us to encounter him daily. Moses said, I don't care. Y'all know the story. God spoke to him, told him to move from my vine, told him to get up out of there. God began to speak to Moses. Moses said, one thing, mama. Because Moses asked a question. Who are you going to send with me? Moses was looking for some physical people. The Lord said, I'm going to go with you. Yeah. Moses made a powerful comment. If you read that, it said, if your presence don't go with me, don't send me.
Yes.
What was he saying, Ski Town family? That my total dependency is not on the people around me, but my total dependency is on the presence that will go with me. Yes. He said, if that is not with me, God don't send me there.
Yes, Lord.
Because dependency is the ground for us to encounter God. If the enemy can take your dependency. See, this is the problem. This is the issue with the church and it's in the body of Christ in general. Our dependency is more on our job than God. Our dependency is more on your family than God. Your dependency is more on your gift than it is the presence. Now, Moses was a phenomenal leader. But he said, I don't care about that. If your presence don't go, don't take it. Mama, he was the man. He had thousands of people, but he said, God, I hear you said I'm going with you. But I'm telling you, if your presence don't go. Mama, he didn't say if you don't go. Because the presence, watch this now, is a manifestation of who he is.
Yeah.
He said, you ain't got to be with me physically. Just give me something I can let me know you're still around.
Yeah.
And that's why I say cry. God, you should do this, you should do that, you should do this. One thing we try our best to do is because our total dependency is on God. When we first started at church, we said, God, how is all this going to happen? What's going to happen? Our total dependency. I had to go to our launch team week after week and tell them, no, they shot us down. No building, Lizette, no building, Lizette, no building. And we didn't get the building until like May 15th.
Yeah.
And service was May 31st.
Yeah.
I mean, our total dependency is on God. say it's the birthing ground.
It's the birthing ground.
You want to encounter him daily? Do not remove your dependency. Moses was so powerful, Pastor. He said, I don't care about who coming with me, but if your presence is not going, do not send me. That must mean my brain, that his presence has some value to it. See, I love it because he valued the presence.
So our dependency should always be on the presence of God first before the promises of God.
That's good.
A lot of times, especially nowadays in church, we are holding on to the promise, holding on to the word of God, holding on to what God said. And God said, what about my presence? Okay, the promise is going to come. Just like when God was talking to the children of Israel, he said, you can go to that place, but I'm not going with you. And so God's saying, you know, let's think about the presence before the promise. Even though I promise you this, yes, you're going to have this, yes, this door's going to open, but will you get into my presence before you worry about the promise? That's going to come. That's already inevitable. That's already signed, sealed, and delivered. But God wants us to get back to that place where the presence is first before his promises.
I know, now that messed y'all up. You're like, what? God told Moses, I'm going to give you the land.
Yep.
He told him that. But Moses still said, in spite of your promise, that's cool.
Yeah.
Where your presence at?
Yeah. Yes, Lord.
Why you say that? Because promises can be taken and given. His promise, his presence, you don't want it to be taken. Because remember, Mama, they didn't have the presence of God like we do. So their value system was on a higher level of his presence. But we got to get to the point where him and the promises, as my wife said, they coming to pass. Absolutely. But I just charge you this afternoon, saint. Don't never let the promises of God outweigh the presence of God. Never let that happen. That you are so driven by a promise that you can't even recognize when presence comes. Amen.
Also, do not allow when the promises do come to leave his presence. Many times, God fulfills what he says he's going to fulfill, and then we feel like this is our relationship. We going off to his promises. Yes, he did this. He opened this door. He opened that door. And then before we know it, we're like, dang, I'm way up here. God, I left God behind. Never, ever, ever leave his presence over his promises. Amen.
We have to have a spirit of dependency for the presence of God. That is something that you got to ask God. Because hear me, I know it's hard. I know in this world, listen to me. The presence of God should be the highest rank over your job. I know you're like, what? Yes. Because your job can be left. The presence will find you another one quick. And Kyle, I've learned, if that's gone, he'll find you one better than what you had. If you just value his presence more than you value things.
And even he'll keep you while you wait for the promises.
He calls
you in his presence. When you have in the moments, you stay in his presence. You're not worried about waiting on the promises of God. Because why? You're in his presence. So if I get it or not, if the door opens or not, if things change breaks or not, God, I'm going to stay in your presence until I see your change come.
Let's watch this. Next scripture. It's about 10 more minutes. Y'all learning something? I know we're not really trying to yell. It's all my fault. If this bores you, then you might want to check your presence of the moment.
Check.
Go ahead, sir.
And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. Mm. And man became a living being.
He did what, y'all? He breathed what?
Breath into his nostrils.
Into his what?
Nostrils.
Or the breath of what?
Life.
And the man became a
living being.
So human beings back here was totally dependent on the breath of life. Because the breath of life, Ski Town family, him brought life to the person. Adam, when he was born, created a form, we see, The Spirit or the breath of God, Taylor, blew himself into man until man became a living being. So that means just like your body need air, your spirit need his presence.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because without your breath, do like this, just hold your breath a little bit until I say stop. If you're going to pass out, stop. But if I can keep going, believe me, it'll catch up to you. Because it's your breath that's allowing you to move. It's your breath that's allowing you to. And what is God saying, man? Just like in a human body, the breath is important. It's just like in the spirit realm, Jonah. The breath is important. Because the breath is the ruach. The breath is the spirit of God. Or it's the spirit of what? Life. So just as man needs breath to live, as believers, we need his presence to live. Y'all have saw people pass away. What is the indicator that they died? There's no more what, y'all? Don't matter if they shab and in there. Once the breath leaves, that very thing, cuz, is not living anymore. It don't take it long, mama, to leave either. Once it's snapped up out the body, life is gone just like this. It don't take 20 years. As soon as the breath leaves, the body shuts down just like. So just as believers, when the breath of life or the spirit of God leaves or the presence of God leaves, your spirit man will die just like. Yeah. And you can be in church, but you're a dead man walking.
Jesus.
Because the spirit of God is the breath of life. And when you're a human being, you value your body because you understand, if this breath leaves, cuz, I'm gone. Why not take that same attitude with our spirit man?
Yes.
Like I protect my natural breath, protect your spiritual breath of life called the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, that's good.
Somebody say, just like this. Life can be gone. Now, I remember my mother passed away more than 10 years. I remember me and Pastor was at the store when we get done. We were about to grab movies, and I'm telling the daughter, son. And the Lord said, rush on. I had the movies in my hand. I think I just dropped the movies there, and my wife left. I went into the room where she was laying. And I turned my head, hear me, for a second. Turn back around. The spirit of breath had left her in seconds. It's like she held that one more breath until I came home. Life is short. But I want to challenge you. If you understand life is short from the physical place, it's just as short from the spiritual place. That's why you have to get educated about that breath of life that's in you. Because, hear me, he's a necessity if you want to keep on living. I didn't say existed. I said keep on living.
So Adam and Eve, they broke their dependency. If you look back in the scripture, they broke their dependency of the presence of God when they were introduced, the devil introduced them to sin. They allowed sin to separate them from the presence of being dependent on the sin, or dependent on the presence of God.
Steve.
They became independent. And you know, people that are independent, they don't need nobody. They don't need nobody. They got it on their own. But God said, I need some dependent people that are desperate for my presence, no matter the cost. house, no matter how it feels, no matter what you're dealing with, I'm dependent on the presence of God. My life depends on your presence. My life depends on your presence. My life depends on your presence. So now God has brought Jesus on the scene and allowed us to get that dependency back, which Adam and Eve had taken from us back in the beginning. So even I want to even, you know, ask yourself, think for a minute, God, have I become too independent where I don't need you only in certain situations? God, have I become independent where I'm only needing you when things are bad, but when things are good, I'm good? Come and think about that for a second. We all need his presence. If you want to go higher in him, where do you need his presence? That's where everything comes from.
Adam and Eve in the garden. The Bible said they walked through the cool of the day.
Yes.
Troy's just kicking and having fun. But the moment Adam and Eve messed up, for a moment they depended on the breath.
Yes.
Because it was the very thing that made them a living being. As soon as Adam and Eve messed up, that thing that was in them left. So because they were physically alive, but spiritually dead. That's deep. Jesus comes back. He recovers that. Where y'all think he recovered that?
In the garden.
In the garden.
Yeah, in the garden.
When he told himself, not my will, but thy will be done. Because he said the very thing that took out first Adam won't be the same thing that took out the last Adam.
Yeah.
And because of that, now we can get back to our total dependency, which is on the presence of God. God got great things for our church. It ain't gonna happen because we're gifted and we all in heaven. It's gonna happen because our total dependency is on the presence of God. There's some people that say, "Why are you moving fast enough?" I don't move by you. I move by presence. 2 years, people been saying, y'all should start recording. We could have, but the presence didn't say that. People said that. And I didn't do it, Carl, until I heard his presence say yes. Because if we're going to be a ministry that shift and do what God called us to do, we can't be moved by people. We got to be moved by his what?
Right.
His presence is what makes the difference.
Yes.
And I want us to get this concept now as God began to expand us. I never want us to lose the nucleus, which is his presence. Because that's going to make people come from Muskegon, Kalamazoo, Detroit. Y'all catch a little bats. You know why? Because not because, oh, they on the chain. Man, when I come there, I know for sure doubt. Them people praying and talking to God, and I'm going to come through them doors, and I'm going to feel nothing but his what? That's what people want. People will pick a church home. I like the pastor, but what if God ain't there? I don't care about that. Mm-hmm.
Well,
it's because we haven't taught y'all how to be educated and trained on his presence. One thing about Adam, the pastor, before he messed up, he loved his presence.
He did.
Let's come to a closer, baby.
He did. So as we close, there is some vacancies or voids in the church today. That is, the church has lost their seat. If we look around globally in many churches, nobody wants to seek God anymore. Nobody wants to include him in your life anymore. Nobody wants to consider his feelings, emotions, his tears when he's grieving about certain things that are going on in the church as a global. But we must be a people that bring back the seat.
Yeah,
we must be a people that bring back his presence.
Yeah.
We must be a people that hold his presence, and when we get together, we just pour it out.
Yeah.
So that people who don't know his presence can recognize it by coming into the sanctuary. God is calling us to bring the seek back into the church. God said, I'm just waiting for you. I'm just waiting for my bride to get back into longing for their seek for my presence. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's go to the scripture.
Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually, longing to be in his presence.
Next one.
The Lord looks down from heaven on the entire human race. He looks to see if anyone is truly wise, if anyone seeks God.
Okay.
Wow. So God is calling us to carry the spirit of seeking.
I love that.
What is that? There is a spirit of seeking. Many of us may even want to ask God now, God, give me that spirit of seeking, which means no matter how I feel, no matter how this flesh feels, I will have the spirit of seeking to always seek you no matter what. To always seek you no matter what the enemy throws my way. To always seek you no matter what I'm facing, but knowing that I'm holding on to your promise and I just want your presence.
Yes, sure.
We must continue to ask God for the spirit of seeking.
When you get the spirit of seeking, what it does is it enables us to seek him continually.
Yeah.
See, you can't seek him continually if you don't carry the spirit of seeking.
Come on.
But when you have the spirit of seeking, which you have the spirit of always discover and find where God is, then you will begin to continue. What it says, seek him, what y'all continue. This thing is, see, when you have the spirit of seeking, this is way past church days. This thing is on you. This thing is in you. You're at your home. Matter of fact, you start raising your kids up.
Yeah, yeah.
To lift their hands.
Yeah.
This is a vacancy. This is a void in church today.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to seek him continually. I'm tired.
So God is looking not just for worshipers, which that is wonderful, that's our task, but he's looking for seekers. He's looking for those that will seek him, that will pull off the pillow, that will pick up this to look, just like you're looking for that phone or that or for your keys. You search until you find it. God is saying, I'm looking for those that will search me till they find me. I'm looking for those, once they find me, they bow down and worship me. That's what God is looking for in this hour. For those that will seek him continually, no matter what. You, it may be hard for you to even get in the presence.
Woo.
God, I want him so much, I don't feel like going in your presence, but God, I'm just going to lay in your presence. God, I'm going to seek you any means necessary. God, I don't care how I feel at this moment. God, I'm still going to seek you because why? I have the spirit of a seeker. Hallelujah.
He's seeking. That's deep. The Bible says, go back. The Lord, what it said, the Lord looks down. Where y'all?
Right.
The entire human what?
Grace.
He's looking.
Yeah, you're praising. That's good. Worship. God is in where's those seekers.
He's looking for you. He's looking for you.
He said, I look within a whole. So as we close, we have to have a desire for the presence of God. That from that desire, it will help us to develop a hunger for the presence of God. And from that developing, it will push us to draw towards the presence of God. And which the drawing will give us a dependency on his presence. And I hope that this wasn't boring to you, because it absolutely was not boring to us.
Yeah.
Next week, we're going to share four more keys. I think and when we start the next quarter, we're going to do a two-week activation. We're going to train you right in service how to hear the same person that we're telling you to synchronize with.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's our job to give you information about him. But hear me, and I'm just being very clear. If you can hear him at one level, don't get arrogant to think, I can hear him good. I can hear him about clearly, but it ain't enough for me. Ain't enough. So please don't let nothing get in the way. We're going to do some activations. I know this is ours. We're going to activate. We're going to ask God to show y'all dreams right in sermon on a Sunday. Right here. It's going to turn into a training school of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
But I want you to hear his voice.
Amen.
Because what if you can't call us? I want you to still hear the voice that counts.
Yeah.
And that is the who? Holy Spirit. So we hope today that this didn't bore you. Because absolutely didn't bore us. Yeah. My advice when you got children, put that in them. See, because I don't want my kids to come to church because they have to.
Right.
I want them to come to church because they desire to.
Yeah.
See, I love my daughter said nine. She's excited when she comes to church. Mm-hmm. And I want her to stay like that. But my job is to make sure church is not a weightless tour, but it's a place where she can encounter God. Mm-hmm. I pray for your children, that your children would know God, that if the teacher in the sixth grade is sick, your little baby can go up there and give him a hug, not knowing there's some healing on your children. See, you got to understand the type of God you deal with. So we're going to spend time, we're going to do it next week, because I know we got dinner, 6:30. Next week, come here, part two. As we deal with four more D's when it comes to the presence of God. Were you blessed today?
Yes.
Come on, give me some praise. Give me some praise. Give me some praise. And Facebook about the Holy Spirit. We did a whole year teaching. And we learned a lot. Extremely a lot. Now this type of stuff, you can't make everybody. Some people are okay. They're comfortable where they're at. But you just have two leaders that never want to get comfortable. But I'm always trying to get deeper in his presence. And that is our desire for you. Just lift your hands. 30 seconds, I just want you to meditate on the word that you just received. He's worthy, church. Next week, come. We won't have anything to do after. And we're going to open up the heavens, man. Just let you just, cause go for him. Let's give Jesus one more great, great hand. He's so good.
Him, draw close to him, desire him. That's what it starts from. So long as you desire, let everything flow. Let everything flow and allow God to move in you and allow his presence to live everywhere you are. Be blessed today. Also know if you feel led to give, go log on to our website, www.g2gglobalministries.com. Click the donate button and they will have instructions further. God bless you. We thank you ahead of time for sowing. We love you and we'll see you next week.
Amen. Jesus is good.